Good evening. My name is Melissa Getford, and I'm the pastor of discipleship here at Tonganoxie United Methodist Church. Welcome. Today is Good Friday, and for centuries, Christians have observed this day as the day that Jesus was arrested, tried, and executed. So this is a somber day. During this service, you'll see some new elements and some very traditional elements. You'll hear some songs, some hymns that you may recognize, some repurposed hymns, and also some new songs. We will hear some readings from ancient scripture that somehow still speaks to us today. And then you'll also see some art depicted on the screens as well. And so I invite you to reflect on these icons as we hear some readings. We'll also partake in communion. It's an ancient meal that has its roots back in Judaism. And so with all of these traditional elements of this worship, my hope for you this day is that you see God, that you experience God in a new light. Will you pray with me?
Oh Lord, we're not paying attention. We do not fully see what you are doing for us, for the world. We are busy taking care of tasks, saving our own skins, living lives of distraction. We are too busy knowingly and unknowingly hurting others of your creation. Tonight we come to your table guilty. Yet we know that we must come here before you and bear our souls to be made clean. Oh gracious God, wash us and make us clean. Make us fit to be your people again. Amen.
Thank you. That table brings back memories. I was sitting at a table kind of like that one, the day that my life changed. It was business as usual for me. People would pass the road, stop by my kiosk, they would pay the usual tax and be on their way. Except, I always tacked on a little extra for myself. Guys gotta eat. They knew I overcharged and they hated it, but they couldn't do anything about it. The government was on my side. So they clenched their jaws and they coughed up the money, mumbling about how they hated tax collectors as they rode off. My people thought I was a traitor, a sellout to the Roman government. I got used to it. It was a lonely job. My only friends were other tax collectors, and they weren't great friends. We were, of course, known for cheating people. It was the middle of the day when I saw Jesus walking down the road. There were quite a few people following him, so I was getting ready for a pretty big income. I had heard about this guy before, the Jewish teacher who preached all about love and some radical ideas about turning the other cheek and giving away your cloak to the guy who stole your shirt. That's not for me. He stopped at the table, and I named my price. His followers rolled their eyes and groaned, and he looked right at me, and he smiled, and he paid it. Ugh. But then he didn't leave. All he said was, "Follow me." Did he know who he was talking to? Did he know what I did for a living? He wanted me to follow him. Did he think that I could do that? That was the first time anyone ever saw me for me and not my job. So I left my table and I followed him. That night I threw a party. I invited all my tax collectors' friends to meet this guy who had believed in me, and I thought maybe he would believe in them too. Some of the religious leaders heard about this and threw a fit. I figured after Jesus got in trouble with his colleagues, he'd leave, but he didn't. Then we all sat down together for a meal. Everybody was welcome at the table with Jesus.
I just hung the damp tablecloth on the clothesline to dry when I saw Jesus and his disciples in the distance. They were coming to our house, and they were early. I panicked. My sister Mary and I were still preparing the meal, and we hadn't even had time to let the bread rise all the way. How could I receive such an important guest like Jesus of Nazareth with a house like this? I ran inside to tell Mary, and our brother Lazarus burst in from the back door at the same time. We both yelled, "Jesus is coming!" We all stared at each other for a split second before we raced to finish our chores. I felt anxious and nervous, but then I looked at Mary, and there was something different in her eyes. She wasn't afraid at all. Sure, there was a sense of urgency, but something told me that she enjoyed the chaos. I envied her sense of adventure and excitement, and boy, did it frustrate me. I kept working harder and faster, and she just kept smiling as she swept the floor. Lazarus said he would meet Jesus at the door to stall, but we still had too much to do. After a while, the group moved into the main room where they were waiting for the meal that we hadn't even started cooking yet. Mary was supposed to be making the hummus, but when I looked over my shoulder, I saw her leave the kitchen and sit down at Jesus' feet and listen to him teach. The nerve! I kept working, but things were taking too long. So I went into the main room and called Mary out. She didn't even care that I had all the work to do by myself, and I told Jesus to tell her to help me. Then something very strange happened. Jesus didn't tell Mary anything. Instead, he looked straight at me, right in my eyes, and he said with pity, "Martha, Martha." He told me I was too worried and distracted. Sure, we needed to eat, but the meal can wait. Mary had chosen the better thing, to engage in real community with real people. instead of always worrying about the next thing to get done. The tablecloth could wait. The bread on this plate reminds me of the time I got to see Jesus teach. I was with my mom and dad. We climbed up a big hill with a huge crowd to follow Jesus. We heard he had done some pretty miraculous things, so we wanted to see for ourselves. There must have been 5,000 people. We listened to him teach about God's love for us, and to be honest, he kind of talked for a long time. We were all getting a little hungry when I heard one of his disciples start to freak out. Then Jesus got kind of weird. He had us sit in groups, and he took my bread and prayed over it. He passed the loaves and fish around and told people to take what they needed. I kind of laughed a little bit because there was no way this food was going to be able to feed all of us. But somehow, it did. Not only did it feed us, we got full before it was all gone. There were leftovers. We followed Jesus up a hill to see a miracle, and that's what we got. Jesus really is bread of life.
It's our anniversary today. I can't believe it's already been 3 years. I remember our wedding so vividly. We planned and prepared for so long, and the celebration week finally came.
Yes, and even though we double-checked to make sure we had enough food and wine, we still ran out.
That was a good party.
It could have been a disaster. We had run out of all the wine, but we still had a whole nother day of celebrations. It would have been so shameful to turn away our guests early. Thank goodness Mary and her son Jesus were there.
Yes, I saw them talking in the corner. And I thought they were making plans to leave, but then Mary brought Jesus to the wait staff, and the next thing I knew, they were filling up the wine jars with water. I mean, our guests had been drinking a lot of wine, but they still would have known the difference between water and wine.
Then when the head waiter tasted it and called you over to talk, I just knew we were going to be humiliated. But it was such a surprise when he told you it was the best wine he had tasted at the whole party. I knew Jesus was a good guy. But to transform water into wine, just to save us from humiliation on our wedding day, was way more generous than I expected. This Jesus guy is the real deal.
A group of prominent religious leaders invited Jesus and his disciples to eat with them. I saw them go into the house when I was headed to the well to draw some water. Simon was the man whose house they visited. I'll never forget the way Simon looked at me as he welcomed Jesus. Such hatred in his eyes, such rage. He looked at me like he thought the world would be better without me. You know, I've made mistakes in my life. I've had to make some tough choices to survive in a world like this. I'm not proud of what I've done. It doesn't make it easier to hear the whispers behind my back, see people turn the other way when I'm walking on their side of the square. Feel their burning stares as I pass. So when Jesus looked at me differently, I noticed. He didn't whisper. He didn't turn away. He didn't stare. He smiled and waved. And our eyes locked for just a second before Simon shooed him into the house. He saw me. I mean, really saw me. Not just as an object or a means to an end, but as a human being. No man had ever treated me like a whole person before. But he did. So I dropped my water and I ran back to my house. I went straight to the hiding spot for all of my valuables, where I took a bottle of my most expensive perfume. It was my life savings. I figured I'd sell it when I got too old to be useful for anyone anymore. So I took the perfume and I went straight for Simon's house. When I burst through the door, I locked eyes with Jesus. And I couldn't hold back my tears any longer. I approached him and I dropped to my knees. My tears fell on his feet, so I wiped them off with my hair. I broke the jar and I spilled my perfume onto his feet. How else could I show him just how thankful I was for treating me like I meant something? I could hear Simon mumbling under his breath. I guess Jesus could too. Jesus looked me in the eyes. He wiped my tear-stained face. He took my hands and stood me up. Then he told a story. A lender had two debtors. One owed enough money to pay 500 people for a day's work. The other owed enough money for 50. When they couldn't pay, the lender forgave the debts of them both. So which one loves the lender more? Simon mumbled, "The one who had the largest debt canceled." He was right. And Jesus did something I'll never forget. He turned to me and he asked Simon, "Do you see her?" Did he see me? Did he really see me? Jesus said that I showed greater love than Simon. Me, a woman, a sinner. As Jesus looked into my eyes one last time, he said the three words I'd been longing to hear for so long. You are forgiven. I lost my life savings that day, but I left with the richest life.
You know, I followed him for about 3 years. Everywhere he went, his presence changed the whole atmosphere. Where there was chaos, he brought calm. And where there was division, he brought peace. And where there was darkness, He brought light. Really, he was light. It was something people said about him even when he was a baby. He was the light of the world, the one who reveals God to those who are living in darkness. For those were the words spoken about him when he was just 8 days old. You know, my life radically changed when I decided to follow Jesus. My brother and I were fishermen by trade, but Jesus said that he would teach us how to fish for people. People who had experienced so much darkness that they didn't even know about the light. So my brother and I learned from him. We followed him all around the region as he preached about God's love for everyone, even those who the rest of the world hated. Sinners, thieves, beggars, tax collectors. The ones so blinded by the darkness that they groped their way through life. Jesus was the light of the world. People started to say that he came into the world so that the blind could see again, literally and spiritually. And everything was different. And once you can see clearly, you can never go back to the dark. But here's what's so radical about him. As if claiming to be the light of the world isn't radical enough. Not only did he say that he was the light of the world, but he also taught that we were the light of the world. Because of Jesus, I, John, son of Zebedee, a fisherman from a small town, I could be the light of the world too. Because of Jesus, I could illumine people's minds and hearts. Because of Jesus, we all could push back the darkness of this world that feels so ominous and invincible. Because of Jesus, the darkness doesn't have the last word in it.
Two thousand years ago, Jesus and his disciples shared a meal. Simple bread, simple wine. A simple reminder, a way of acting out God's saving work in the world. 2,000 years later, we still share this meal. It's our story, remembering God's work and remembering the ways in which God continues to save our world. Tonight, we will share in this meal. I'd like to invite those who are helping with communion to please come forward. On the night in which he was betrayed, tonight, Jesus took a loaf of bread, and he gave thanks for it, and he lifted it up and broke it. This is my body. It's going to be broken for you tonight. And then he took a cup. One they no doubt shared many times before, and he gave thanks for it like always, but then he said, "This is my blood. Tonight it will be poured out for you, for many, for all, for the forgiveness of all of our sins. As often as you drink of this, do so in remembrance of me." Communion was a gift that Jesus gave us, gave all people, not just this church, so you don't have to be part of this church to take it. Jesus offers it to you tonight. When you come to take, you'll hold your hands out in front of you. You'll be given just a piece of the body of Christ. broken for you. The body of Christ, broken for you. Take and dip just the corner of that into the cup. The blood of Christ, shed for you. The blood of Christ, shed for you. Take and receive. Take and remember. Take and experience the sacrifice of Christ tonight. Let us pray. Almighty God, you offered yourself for us 2,000 years ago, and 2,000 years later, we still offer our lives back to you. God, we offer these elements, bread and juice. In them, may we find you. In them, may we experience the grace that comes from you. In them, may we be forgiven by you. Make these elements for us, your body, your blood, your life, given tonight. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. Come to the table. Come and receive the offering of new life.
Transgressions, bruised for our iniquities, you bought a peace and brought a healing. Now eternally we sing. Now eternally we sing. Hosanna.
Hosanna in the highest.
wounded deep for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities. You bought a peace and brought a healing, now eternally we sing. Now eternally we sing. Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna in the highest, Hosanna in the highest.
A suffering God, our wounded healer, lonely there upon the cross, crowned with thorns, now crowned with glory, reigning at the Father's side. Thou once despised, thou once rejected, Lamb of God, our sacrifice. You came and died for our forgiveness, rose again to bring us life. Hosanna.
Transgressions, bruised for our iniquities. You bought a peace and brought a healing. Now eternally we sing. Now eternally we sing. Hosanna.
Our scripture lesson this evening comes from the 26th chapter of the Gospel of Matthew, beginning at the 26th verse. Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane. He said to his disciples, "Stay here while I go and pray over there." When he took Peter and Zebedee's two sons, he began to feel sad and anxious. Then he said to them, "I'm very sad. It's as if I'm dying. Stay here and keep alert with me." Then he went a short distance farther and fell on his face and prayed, "My Father, if it's possible, take this cup of suffering away from me. However, not what I want, but what you want." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Go to dark Gethsemane, feel the tempter's power. Your Redeemer's conflict see, watch him with 1 hour. Turn not from his griefs away, turn not from his griefs. Learn of Jesus Christ to pray. Turn not from his griefs.
Tonight is not a celebration. We spend this evening on some of the hardest and most painful verses in the Bible. In some ways, we see the whole of the gospel spread before us on a table. All of these symbols of all of the ways that Jesus taught and loved, that he cared and led. All of the ways that Jesus changed the lives of people around him. And yet on tonight, we watch as little by little they slip away. Tonight we remember the story as one by one they became broken. Now for Martha, the cloth had been a symbol, a reminder of God's love for her, not because of the work that she did, but because of who God was. They were a reminder that she did not have to earn God's presence, but instead could stop and rest. For the disciples, the tablecloth was a reminder of God's rhythm, God's cadence, a reminder to breathe, to Sabbath, to take a moment and enjoy God's presence, to take a moment and remember to stop. It was a powerful reminder. They should have taken it. See, on the last night of Jesus' life, he gathered with his disciples, and after they finished a meal, he took them to a garden called Gethsemane. And Jesus knew something was about to happen, so he gathered his disciples and said, "Please, I need you tonight. Please pray with me. Please pray for me." And as Jesus closed his eyes to pray, so did his disciples. And Jesus prayed a powerful prayer, "Father, let this cup pass from me, but not my will, but yours be done." But while Jesus eyes were closed to pray, his disciples' eyes were closed to sleep. Perhaps it was the wine, perhaps it was the meal, perhaps it was just the busy pace of their lives, day after day after day, forgetting to rest, forgetting that God invites them to breathe, to remember. But day after day, they became more and more worn down until day after day, they were exhausted. And on this night, the night in which Jesus needed them the most, they had nothing left to give. And so on this night, Jesus awakes. He rises from his prayer. He opens his eyes and sees his disciples still slumbering. And he nudges them and says, "Peter, please pray with me." And again, Jesus prays. And again, the disciples sleep. And a third time, Jesus rises from prayer and opens his eyes and sees the disciples again sleeping. And his heart breaks. The rhythm of their life had left them with nothing left. Sometimes the pace of our own lives does the same. We think that our value is based on what we can do, how much we can work, what we can produce. And we forget that God has a rhythm for our life that is unlike any other. That God sometimes invites us to a different cadence, a different rhythm. That sometimes God invites us to rest. We forget that and we get farther and farther behind, more and more exhausted. Sometimes we, like the disciples, forget the message and the symbolism of the tablecloth. Sometimes we, like the disciples, can't even keep our eyes open for prayers because we are so run down. Sometimes we forget that God has a rhythm and a cadence for our lives. Now for John, the candle had been a symbol of light, a reminder that Jesus pushes back the darkness in our world. For the disciples, it was a symbol, a reminder of the candlelight on that final meal, that last supper, as they'd seen one another bathed not in just the light of how things were, but softly illuminated by the message of God's grace, as they saw each other as they might be. But on that night, even the light of Christ seemed to fade. See, while Jesus was praying, while the disciples were sleeping, no one was watching to notice as little by little a mob began to get closer and closer and closer. No one noticed as this mob got to the very gates of the garden. No one noticed until it was too late. And this mob comes, carrying clubs and torches. At the head of this mob is a familiar figure. It's Judas, the man who for years has been one of the disciples and yet now has become their betrayer. And Judas stops the mob at the entrance to the garden and walks up to Jesus. His face is stuck in a strange expression, and he offers his Lord an awkward embrace. Judas says, "Greetings, Rabbi." And Jesus looks at him and says, "Do what you came to do." Now, the clamor of the mob is loud enough, it finally rouses the disciples from their slumber, and they awake, and they awake with a start and with fear. Peter, the rash, the impetuous, the brash disciple, draws a sword and begins to swing wildly at this mob, trying to beat them off, trying to defend Jesus. He cuts off the ear of one of the high priest's relatives. The moment is tense. A mob on one side, disciples on the other. Jesus steps into the tension and stands between the two opposing forces, and he calms things for a moment. He heals the ear of the man who Jesus had cut. But he notices that things are still not as they could be. No longer are they illuminated by the light of God's grace. Instead, harsh torchlight flickers between the faces of these two opposing mobs. The crowd following Judas came with clubs. Their intent is clear. The disciples love Jesus. Their resolve is no less. They will defend him to the death, or so they claim. The messages of Jesus, of peace, of turning the other cheek, seem to be lost in this moment. The candlelight, the hope of seeing one another as God calls us to be, not as we currently are, but as we might one day be through the grace of God, is snuffed out, and it's replaced by the angry flicker of the torch of hate. And too often we see this in our own world. We no longer give one another the benefit of the doubt. Instead, we see others as them to be feared, them to be hated. And hatred is just what fear looks like in public. We hate those who aren't like us and who disagree with us. And all too often in our world, we find that because of that fear, the light of Christ is snuffed out and replaced with a torch of hate.
See him in the judgment hall, beaten, bound, arraigned. Oh, the wormwood and the gall, the pangs his soul sustained. Shun not suffering and shame, oh, shun not suffering. Learn of Christ to bear the cross, shun not suffering.
For the woman who washed Jesus' feet, the basin and towel were a reminder that Jesus cleanses us of our shame. She had a long and painful life, and yet Jesus had washed her clean while she washed his feet. Jesus had called her fully human, wiped out the sting of shame. Now, for the disciples, at first the basin did bring them shame as they watched, as Jesus walked into a room and as he kneeled in front of them and took the basin and towel and began to lovingly wipe their feet clean. They watched in shame as this man who was their Lord became their slave. But little by little, through his actions that night, they began to understand that Jesus, in fact, wipes us all clean from shame. That Jesus is wiping out shame from our world. Shame from our sins. Perhaps it was that memory of shame, that memory of not being the one to do what Jesus was forced to do, that drove Peter in the evening. See, as the mob carried Jesus, as they arrested him and took him to the house of the high priest for a trial, all the disciples fled except for Peter. Peter, perhaps remembering the shame of that evening, follows at a distance. Bold Peter. Rash Peter. Peter gets to the courtyard of the high priest. It's the early hours of the morning now. Jesus is dragged inside the home, but Peter stays outside, hoping to avoid shame. Jesus has told him, tonight you will deny me three times. Peter knows that that is not his intention. And so as Peter stands warming himself by the fire, he hears a voice. A young person comes up to him and asks, hey, are you with Jesus, the man that we just arrested? Peter's fear gets the best of him. No, I'm not with him. Now a crowd hears their conversation and begins to grow a little larger, and they gather around Peter and they ask, are you sure you're not with that man? And Peter's fear begins to grow with the side of the crowd, and Peter says, no. Perhaps a whimper this time. And now the crowd has turned their attention fully on Peter. And one of them asks him, a young girl, the lowest slave in the high priest's household, asks Peter, are you sure? Because your accent sounds like his. You must be from the same town as him. What are you doing here in the early hours of the morning if it's not to follow him? And Peter, even in the face of this young girl, is terrified. His courage is run out, and Peter, this bold, brash, hard fisherman, breaks. Peter calls down curses on himself. He says, I don't know what you're talking about. I never knew that man. Peter shouts it with fury, I do not know the man. Peter curses himself and curses them, and a rooster crows. And Peter remembers. Peter is covered in shame. Sometimes we're Peter. Sometimes we give in to the roar of the crowd. Sometimes we give in to our own fear. Sometimes we do things that we look back on and we promised we would never do them. We swore we would never do them. And they happen. And there are places in our own lives where we forget the work of Jesus on that night, in places where we're covered in shame. For the couple, at their wedding, Jesus' cup had been a reminder of Jesus' abundance. This was a reminder that God has an extravagant love for us that shows up in unexpected ways. For the disciples at the Passover, this was a reminder of the way that God had rescued their ancestors. It was a reminder that when they had cried out, God had heard them. When they'd been trapped in slavery, God had rescued them. When they'd been just wrecked by sin, God had redeemed them. When all they could see in themselves was their brokenness, God had called them his own, and that God was always holding out hope for each of them. This was what the disciples learned about the cup of Christ that night. This was what it meant to them, but Judas had slipped out too early. He'd missed the message. When Judas realized what he'd done, that he'd betrayed his Lord and his friend, he was cut to the heart. He ran to the high priest and he begged them to let Jesus go. He offered back the money they'd paid him. He threw it at them, saying, please forgive me for what I've done, but they already had what they wanted. Judas was broken. He felt he had no hope. And so Judas went to a field and he took a rope and it began to look like the best way out. Judas forgot that God hears us, even when we are slaves. Tears running down his cheeks, he cries, and yet he forgot that God hears us when we cry. Judas took the rope and began to fasten a noose around his own neck, drawing it tighter and tighter and tighter. He felt trapped in what he felt like he had to do. He forgot that Jesus taught us that he will always free us when we are captured. Judas began to climb a tree, branch after branch, intent on ending his own life, caught up in the iniquity of his sin. He forgot that the cup symbolizes that God redeems us when we are sinful. Judas began to take that rope, to tie it tighter and tighter and tighter around the branch of a tree. He prepared to leap because he forgot that God sees past what we've done and that God calls us his own. And Judas, seeing no way forward, leapt. He took his own life because he forgot that Jesus taught us that he will always have hope for us. That even in the most broken times, Jesus still loves us. Sometimes we're like Judas. Sometimes we forget that God hears us when we cry. Sometimes we forget that God frees us when we feel trapped. Sometimes we forget that God redeems us when we are sinful. Sometimes we forget that even though we feel trapped and defined by our own mistakes, that God still calls us his own. Sometimes we forget that God always has hope for us. And sometimes in life, we leap. That brings us to the plate. For the young man with the small lunch, this was a reminder of God's abundance. For the disciples around that first communion table, this was a reminder of Christ's abundant sacrifice, how his love and his mercy covered over all our sins. But for Pilate, that sacrifice didn't remove the guilt. It heaped more on top. See, Pontius Pilate was the Roman governor in charge of deciding the fate of Jesus. He was the man who knew Jesus was innocent, but yet still condemned him as guilty. And Pilate was the man that we remember as full of guilt himself. Pilate knew that Jesus was innocent and knew that he should do his better. His own wife grabbed him and said, "Have nothing to do with that man." But Pilate didn't hear her. He heard the roar of the crowd. Now, Pilate didn't need to listen to them. Pilate was the man entrusted with power over everything in the area. He was the Roman governor. He should have known better. Pilate should have stood for justice instead of heaping guilt upon himself. Pilate, as the Roman governor, had the ultimate power. He was the man charged with keeping order. He was the man, the representative of the empire that stretched from Scotland to Jerusalem. He was the man that would have brought law to all places. He could have taken the life of anyone there with a word. But he was afraid of the crowd. The plate reminds us that Christ's sacrifice wipes out our guilt. But for Pilate, he couldn't get out of his own way enough to stop heaping more and more and more guilt upon himself. The crowd began to shout louder for Jesus' blood. Pilate knew the man was innocent, and so he began to bargain with them. "Who do you want, Jesus, the healer, or Barabbas, the murderer? I'll release one of them to you. Surely, maybe this bargain will put things back into sharp illustration. Who should I give to you today, surely thou want a man of peace, not a man of the sword, right? And yet the crowd begins to shout Barabbas. Pilate's afraid. He asks, what should I do then with Jesus? He's done nothing wrong. We all know this. And the crowd doesn't need an excuse. They begin to shout, crucify. So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, handed an innocent man over to be killed. Sometimes, we're like Pilate. We're afraid of the crowd. We're afraid of what they might do to us or that they might not like us. We have the power to say no, but we don't have the will. Sometimes we're like Pilate, sometimes we're the crowd. And we know what's best, but we do what's worst. And no matter where we are, we've all made mistakes. And Jesus knew that. Jesus knew that there would be people who would sin on accident, people who would sin on purpose, people who would sin all the time. And like Pilate, like the crowd, like you and like me, that there would be times that we're the reason Jesus would hold a loaf, break it in half, saying the words that haunt us still. This is my body, and it's broken for you.
Calvary's mournful mountain climb, adoring at his feet. Mark that miracle of time, God's sacrifice complete. It is finished, hear him cry, oh, it is finished, done. Learn of Jesus Christ to die, it is finished, done.
For Matthew, the table was a surprise. See, he was the worst in his society. He was the man with only the friends he could buy. He was the man who never expected to hear somebody say, come, be with me. He didn't expect to have a place made for him, certainly not by the King of Kings. And yet, for Matthew, the table was a reminder that God makes space for us before we deserve it, not because we deserve it. For the disciples, it was a surprise for them as well, because they were all normal people. They didn't expect to take part in any great adventure. They were poorly educated, poorly connected, people living in a backwater of the largest empire on earth. Nobody expected greatness from them, except for Jesus. When he said, hey, come, follow me, and I'll lead you on something that will change the universe. Jesus made space for them at the table and invited them to make space for all people. And on that night, the table began to break. Jesus spent the night in jail. He spent the night alone in a prison cell. We might call it a cave. No light, little air. In the morning, they swing the door open and they drag him out in the light, blinking after the darkness. It's not for freedom, though. They take Jesus and they strap his arms, they tie them down against a post, and they begin to whip him, to flog him, to rip the flesh off his back. But when they untie him, it's still not for freedom. His body is broken. Soon his life will be too. When Jesus rises, he faces a symbol that was raised across the Roman world with one purpose, the cross. We wear it as a necklace. In the ancient world, it was a symbol of hate and pain death. The cross was a way that the Romans killed people. It was a method of execution designed scientifically to produce maximum pain over maximum duration. It was designed to kill a person as painfully as possible and to do it so publicly that all who saw it were terrified. It was a way of saying, we are in charge and we will do it how we want to do it, and if you step over the line, we will kill you. This was the cross. The cross was the opposite of the table. It was Rome's way of saying, we are in charge of the world, and all who do not fit into our way of thinking, all who do not do what we want to do, do not have a place and will not keep their lives. The cross. It faced Jesus. As he stepped up from the whipping post, they handed him a crossbar. He would have been forced to carry it, part of his own execution, his own electric chair, to stumble step by step over the cobbled streets of Jerusalem, to stumble step by step towards Golgotha, the place of the skull. The place of death. The wood drives into the fresh cuts in his back. The sweat and blood drip down his forehead, step by step. Every time Jesus falls, they beat him until he stands again. They arrive at Golgotha. They stretch out his arms on the crossbar and drive nails into his wrists, holding him there. They attach his feet with nails as well. They raise the cross. Jesus looks down on the world he came to save. He looks down on the people he loves. And he sees a world so against everything he stood for. Jesus looks at a world that seems so busted, so broken. Jesus looks down and his breath begins to fall short. Now, Jesus isn't on the cross as long as many were, because the wounds, the exhaustion, the lack of food, the lack of sleep begin to take their toll. Jesus begins to draw ragged breaths. He cries out, I thirst. And they mock him still. Jesus looks down at a world divided by hate. He looks down at a world so full of shame, at a world that feels no grace, at a world that has no room for anybody but their own. He looks down at a world so opposite of the table, so opposite of everything he came for. His breath becomes fainter now. He looks at people that he loves. And he sees that many of those that he longs to see now have fled. He looks at those who die next to him, and one of them mocks him. In his last breaths, insulting the man who gave his last breath for us. Jesus looks down at a world that's broken. Desperate to send one final message, Jesus begins to draw strength. He begins to set his feet to prepare for one final breath, one final message, to give one final word of hope to all people. He stretches his arms tight and begins to pull up. His breath is ragged now. He sees those around him. And though they hung him here, he still loves them. He hopes with one final breath to give one final message of hope, one final message that there is a better way, one final message that it doesn't have to be like this. He hopes with one final breath to make room for all people at God's table. The wood begins to dig into his back. The blood grows fleeting. he becomes exhausted, but still with hope. He draws deep for one more word, one breath, deeper and deeper, ragged and broken, but with one hope that with one word he might finally bring some hope, some message that there is a better way, some message even to the people that have hung him here, that there is a new way. He digs deep, he breathes hard, and with one desperate look, he looks at the people who broke him, and with love, he springs out one final word. It is finished.
Death don't have no mercy in this land. Death don't have no mercy in this land. He'll come to your house and he won't stay long. Look in the bed and somebody will be gone. Death don't have no mercy in this land. Death don't have no mercy in this land. Death don't have no mercy in this land. He'll come to your house and he won't stay long. Look in the bed and somebody will be gone. Death don't have no mercy in this land.
Lord, on this darkest of nights, we sit with your disciples who abandoned you. We denied you three times, sat in the darkness, afraid to show our faces, much less do your will. We are frozen from living, much less doing your righteousness and justice. As we listen to your story told again, we hear once more how costly it was to you for us to be able to say, in the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Help us in our unbelief, in our inaction. Amen.